Heights on NewsWatch. More evidence of a sluggish economy. Why hiring is at a near standstill. Plus, a new report shows Americans are fatter than ever. How could a dozen states top 30% obesity? And NASA's last space shuttle blasts into history. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. And good evening, everyone. I'm Lee Webb. Tough news tonight for the nation's shaky economy. The U.S. added just 18,000 jobs in the month of June. That is the lowest number added in 9 months. The unemployment rate rose to 9.2%. Mark Martin has reaction from the president, Republicans, and Democrats in tonight's top story.
The far worse than expected jobs report comes on top of tense negotiations over raising the nation's debt ceiling.
Our economy as a whole just isn't producing nearly enough jobs for everybody who's looking.
President Obama and congressional leaders from both parties say the jobs report is bold evidence that something needs to be done quickly to get the deficit under control. Republicans say the report shows that Washington needs to control its spending to help boost job growth.
I'm sure the American people are still asking the question, where are the jobs? The stimulus spending binge, excessive government regulations, and our overwhelming debt continue to hold back job creators around our country.
The deficit plan being discussed by the president and Speaker Boehner would cut $4 trillion over the next 10 to 12 years. The president says both parties will go through political pain. Republicans are proposing reductions in entitlement spending on Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security. Democrats say no way.
We do not support cuts in benefits for Social Security and Medicare.
Democrats are calling for tax hikes and for closing tax loopholes, including ending subsidies for oil and gas companies, ending business tax breaks, and capping the tax deductible for wealthy Americans. Republicans say tax hikes will only make things worse.
The other side insisting that we raise taxes. Now, it just does not make sense for Americans to suffer under higher taxes in an economy like this.
President Obama and the bipartisan House and Senate leadership will meet again at the White House on Sunday. If there's no deal by August 2nd, the government will run out of money. For now, the White House and Republicans acknowledge the two sides are still very far apart. Mark Martin, CBN News.
And joining us now is economic expert Kyriakos Zouras. He is a best-selling author and also a former advisor to President George W. Bush. Mr. Zouras, first of all, tell us what, in your opinion, is the best way to jumpstart jobs in this country?
Well, I think that we really need to take a look at not increasing taxes at all and actually putting programs in place where we can reduce taxes for small business, allowing the small business to start growing and start hiring people. That would be the first step. And also to put a curb and a cut on additional spending and stop taking on additional debt.
There are a lot of folks saying that the Republicans need to compromise. Do you think they need to compromise?
Well, yeah, I think there should be compromising on both sides. When you're having a skyrocketing debt, you can't keep printing money and keep raising the debt ceiling. There has to be a point where you look at something and you say, okay, if we're going to raise this, we need to lower this. You can't just keep going in one direction. So I think that both sides need to compromise, and I think something needs to be done so we can come to a solution quickly.
This 9.2 unemployment rate, certainly not what the Obama administration wanted to hear on this Friday. Do you think it's going to get worse?
I think it is going to get worse, and it's certainly not what we were told we were going to get originally. 3.5 million jobs were supposed to be created by 2010. We hit that mark. We didn't hit that mark. We were at 2.4 million at a cost of $666 billion, and we still have 14 million Americans that are unemployed today.
And what about the overall economy? Is it going to get worse?
I believe it's going to get worse. I think we're going to be in a double-dip recession. I think we're just going to keep going again. It looks good, and I think it's going to go down again, and it's going to get worse before it gets better.
Double-dip recession. What are those indicators that make you say that?
Well, the unemployment rate, the underemployment rate, you put those two together, it's not good.
You've written a best-selling book called How to Succeed When Everyone Else is Failing. What's the secret here, apart from all the politics about jobs? How can folks succeed in this economy?
Well, you need to be able to assert yourself and whatever your talents are, If you're in a small business, and that's pretty much primarily what my book is about. It's about small business. It's a small business guide. It's about connecting with your customers and your community and doing business in a way that we used to do years ago, where we had some value and we had commitment and involvement in our community and just doing business the old-fashioned way. And that's how people stay in business today, if you think about it. It's not about sales. It's not about flashy things. It's about giving people a value and being consistent and standing behind what you do and letting them know that you care about them and that they mean something to you. And if you look around at the businesses that are successful, they're the ones that are connecting with the community and their customer, and they're staying alive today amongst all the bad news in the economy.
Old-fashioned ideas that keep working. Kerrieko Zuras, thanks for being with us. We appreciate it.
My pleasure. Thank you.
America's obesity problem has gotten out of control fast. Shocking new numbers reveal how fat our country is. Medical reporter Lori Johnson is here to talk about the problem. Lori, this is shocking, these numbers.
And you know, Lee, that I have done so many stories about how obesity is dangerous. It causes heart disease, cancer, diabetes. It messes up your back and your knees. First Lady Michelle Obama has this program to reduce obesity. But despite all this, our waistlines are still growing at breakneck speed.
America is at a point now where in two-thirds of the states, 25% of the population is obese. Not just overweight, obese. Mississippi's is 34%. But get this, just 20 years ago, no state had an obesity rate above 15%. All this extra fat has taken a toll on our health and our finances.
Being overweight is expensive. People tend to complain that eating healthy costs too much money, but you know, when you think about it, it's very expensive when you're heavy. You have more medication costs, more medical bills. You spend a lot of money on food as well because you excessively snack and you buy things that you wouldn't be buying if you were eating properly.
Experts say there are many reasons we've ballooned as a nation, but it all falls under the umbrella of lifestyle. Shannon Ferry lives in Philadelphia, home to all kinds of delicious yet unhealthy food.
There's so much food to eat. We love the food. We love the cheesesteaks. We love the Philly cream cheese on our bagels. And being close to New York, we have the New York style bagels, the Philly cheesesteaks on the soft rolls, with, you know, just overflowing with the meat and the onions, the grilled onions, the cheese, the sauce, and there's so many places that compete for who has the best cheesesteak.
Food is constantly getting better tasting. Portions are ever increasing, and it's never been so readily available. Why, you can even go whitewater rafting and then pig out on the riverbank.
We do bacon-wrapped scallops, but then we dress it with a creamy cilantro dressing.
We're going to have a peach salsa to go along with it.
Pretty cool experience when you go out to the river and you're like on the river intense, and then you get a chocolate mousse served to you for dessert, and you're like, yes, awesome, right on. And then we'll do a middle of warmed brie.
So we all know this. Temptation is everywhere, and it often begins with seeing it. You know, the TV shows and the checkout line at every store, and then the portion sizes are way too big. You know, our stomachs are only about the size of our fist, so we really don't need very much food. And Lee, to give you an example of how our portion sizes have grown, if you were to buy an old house that still has its original kitchen cupboards, our modern-day dinner plates would not fit into it. You'd have to replace the cupboards, right? Because, you know, back in the 40s, dinner size plates used to be like this. Wow. Now they're like this, yeah, and growing.
Well, still, the bacon-wrapped scallops with the creamy cilantro dressing does sound appetizing.
Makes your mouth water, doesn't it?
Does. Thank you, Lori. Now to a disturbing story tonight about a baseball fan who died trying to catch a foul ball at a Texas Rangers baseball game. We warn you that this video is shocking. Rangers fan Shannon Stone was trying to catch a foul ball thrown by center fielder Josh Hamilton. The video shows him catching the ball but losing his balance and tumbling over head first.
As an organization and as our team members and our staff, we're very heavy-hearted about this, and our thoughts and prayers go out to the family.
And we echo those prayers for Shannon Stone's family. By the way, Shannon was a lieutenant with his local fire department. His family issued a statement saying they are devastated by the tragedy, but thankful for all the support they've received. In other news, the House voted today to slow the new policy allowing homosexuals to serve openly in the military. The measure blocks funding for training manuals for military chaplains. Republicans say they want to keep chaplains from being required to perform same-sex marriages on military installations. Republicans added the amendment to the defense spending bill. An influential pro-family group in Iowa called the Family Leader is asking the 2012 presidential candidates to sign a marriage pledge. The document includes everything from defending traditional marriage to staying faithful to their spouses. Ephraim Graham has that story.
The Family Leader wants all GOP candidates and President Obama to endorse its pledge titled The Marriage Vow. It's a promise to stand for things like the Defense of Marriage Act, something candidate Michelle Bachmann has not shied away from.
I believe that this is such a fundamental issue to our nation, the strengthening of the family and the importance of marriage between a man and a woman, that I will stand for that.
Key points in the conservative pledge include vigorous opposition to redefining marriage, prompt reform of anti-marriage policies and divorce law, and defense of freedom of speech and the right to stand for faithful heterosexual monogamy. Several of the 2012 GOP candidates have already made their position on marriage clear.
We're united in our belief in the importance and significance of marriage between one man and one woman.
I stand tall and proud for traditional marriage. You can't reopen the definition of marriage. That would not be a good thing. It would be wrong for us to be discussing that.
Bad behavior by politicians like John Edwards, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and Anthony Weiner also led Platts to include wording on infidelity. If elected, participants pledge personal fidelity to their spouse and respect for the marital bonds of others. But the group says it won't hold past misdeeds against politicians who've admitted their mistakes.
I found that I was felt compelled to seek God's forgiveness. Not God's understanding, but God's forgiveness. And that I do believe in a forgiving God.
The vow even includes family-friendly economic policies requiring a, quote, commitment to downsizing the government and the enormous burden upon American families. The group wants candidates to sign the pledge by August 1st. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
History at the Kennedy Space Center today in Florida. The 135th and final shuttle mission lifted off 30 years and 3 months after the very first shuttle flight.
Burning, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff.
What a sight. Heavy downpours and lightning, as you can see here, threatened the launch, but they did get off. Debates over cost and the risk of human life finally put an end to the shuttle program. Atlantis will carry 8,000 pounds of supplies to replenish the International Space Station. The flight will last 12 days. Coming up, a walking miracle. Palestinian terrorists stab two hikers in Israel and leave them for dead. But hear why doctors say one of them makes a miraculous recovery.
I'm Sylvia, and I am an alcoholic. My addiction made me feel dead inside. I am full of joy. I was so lucky to pick Hemet Valley Recovery Center to come, where there were people who understood me. And that's very special.
Hemet Valley Recovery Center and Sage Retreat. Take the first step.
Are you anxious to protect your family with life insurance, but afraid you can't afford it? Well, look how much insurance many people can get through SelectQuote for less than a dollar a day. SelectQuote found Rich, 37, a $500,000 policy for under $18 a month. Even though Dave, 43, takes meds to control his blood pressure, SelectQuote got him a $500,000 policy for under $28 a month. Ellen, 47, got a $250,000 policy for under $20 a month. All it takes is a phone call. Your personal SelectQuote agent will answer all your questions and impartially shop the highly rated term life companies SelectQuote represents for your best rates. Give your family the security it needs at a price you can afford. Call this number or go to SelectQuote.com. SelectQuote, we shop, you save.
If you're an individual group or business needing a dental plan, Avia Dental offers group plans for as little as $5 per month. Now members of your group can save up to 50% or more off a high-quality dental care. Everyone qualifies, and there's no waiting or limits on visits to the dentist. Visit aviadental.com or call 1-888-431-CARE. Avia Dental since 1994. Smile, you're with people who care.
The crime made headlines around the world. Two hikers stabbed by Palestinian terrorists and left for dead. One of the victims survived. And CBN's Julie Stahl explains why doctors call Kay Wilson a walking miracle.
Last December, Israeli tour guide Kay Wilson took her friend Christine Lucan hiking on the Israel Trail outside Jerusalem. What happened that day changed her life forever.
We were walking not far from here, in fact, in this, on the brow of the hill over here, and we were caught by surprise by two Palestinian terrorists. They stabbed us both, each one of us 12 times.
Wilson survived by playing dead. Then she and her dog Peanut, who was also stabbed, walked almost a mile to this picnic table where she found help. Police found Lucan's body the next day.
She told me the details of what happened step by step, where she went.
During the attack, Wilson stabbed one of the terrorists. DNA from her penknife helped police arrest her attackers.
I think she's a real brave and great woman, yeah. That's what I think, because what she did that night was really unbelievable.
Wilson returned to that park recently as a tour guide to encourage Israelis not to be afraid.
I feel in some ways it could be redemptive. I think the best revenge for terror is to live well and live a life of meaning and not stop what we're going to do and not sit at home, because that's exactly what they want.
Despite the attack, Wilson says Israel is no more dangerous than anywhere else, and tourists should still come visit. She would also like people to remember the enthusiasm of her slain friend, Christine Lucan, an American Christian.
She was never bland about anything. Enthusiasm is contagious, so that's what I'd want to convey to people, and also the fact that she really did dedicate her life to the Jewish people.
Another friend, Annie Saliebowitz, told Wilson, although the terrorists stabbed her 12 times, God had actually saved her life 12 times.
I've just learned that when one is faced with such incredible violence and such a terrible evil attack, that God is always there, and that we have so much to be grateful for.
And that's exactly the message Wilson wants to convey.
I'll never know why Christine died and I survived, but the thing that made me get up when I had those terrible injuries, it was the fact that I wanted to live. This idea that my life has been given back and we have a mandate to live. And all that means.
Julie Stahl, CBN News, the Jerusalem Forest.
I noticed a rather large bump underneath my left rib cage.
Chris Parrish was about to hear two words that would bring her to her knees and change her life forever.
When you say, oh, I have pancreatic cancer, oh, I'm sorry. That's what people think, is that you're gonna die. And that's when the research started, and I pulled up Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
I was in Chicago in 3 days. I knew it was meant to be as soon as I walked through the doors. The place renewed my faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
Never once did the doctors or the nurses mention you have 6 months to live. It was all about what we can do to make you feel better. I had my scan results. I had my blood work the next day. You're meeting with all these people in one place. Dr. Levin, he knew that I was ready to fight. He was ready to start right in on the inner arterials the first day. This is the biggest fight I've ever had, and I don't like losing.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
You feel that security in knowing that they aren't going to give up on you. My milestone in the beginning of my treatments were putting my feet on the floor and having another day. The little milestones turn into bigger milestones. I just celebrated 2 years of being treated but being alive. And that was huge.
Please call or go to cancercenter.com today. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Like many instant celebrities, Bristol Palin found that the national spotlight can be harsh. News broke of her pregnancy just as her mother began her run for vice president a couple of years ago. She writes about the whirlwind that followed in her new book. Wendy Griffith talked with Bristol Palin in New York about the book and the role of forgiveness in her life.
Bristol Palin is just a few months away from her 21st birthday. As the eldest daughter of Todd and Sarah, she grew up in wild, rugged Alaska, where fishing, hunting, and traveling by snowmobile are a way of life. Bristol excelled in sports, where she learned how to take the hard hits, something that would come in handy later in life. She was known as a good girl who made good grades and stayed out of trouble. So no one, especially her parents, suspected that their 17-year-old daughter would soon reveal to the world that even good girls can make very bad decisions. I recently sat down with Bristol in New York to talk about her new book, Not Afraid of Life, My Journey So Far, where she talked about the night she lost her virginity after drinking too many wine coolers.
It was something that I was ashamed of and I didn't own up to until I got pregnant, until the whole world knew that I wasn't a virgin.
How did your parents react to the news that their 17-year-old daughter is pregnant?
It was definitely a huge shock, first and foremost. Definitely disappointment, but my family were so close-knit. It's like, okay, yes, this situation's not ideal, but we're going to get through it with the help of God and with the help of our other family members.
Fast forward about 5 months later, 4 months later, you're on a national stage, your mom's announcing for Vice President of the United States, and the world just finds out that you're pregnant. What was that like?
Definitely something hard to go through. And I write about in my book too, I kind of felt like I had that scarlet letter attached to me, like, sleaze or whatever anyone could say about me. But I'm so much stronger because of that experience.
You have recommitted to waiting to have sex until you're married. Are you going to practice what you preach?
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't think it's going to be a difficult battle because I've seen the consequences of it, and it's not worth it.
Bristol says the pain and loneliness of being a single mom and the heartache of the boy's father, Levi, not wanting to see his son caused her to cry out to God.
That night was so meaningful and such a point where I'll remember it for the rest of my life because it was rock bottom. It was like, okay, I'm done trying to do everything myself. I'm done trying to change Levi. I'm done trying to do all this stuff. I need your help, God.
And you said that night, for really the first time, you felt God's forgiveness.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And you said it's a pretty good deal.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. from that moment forward, it was like a whole new page.
Of course, when you look at your 2.5-year-old son, Tripp, you don't see a mistake.
Oh, no. He is the biggest blessing in my life, and he really is the love of my life.
Why risk putting yourself out there and the intimate details of your life in this book?
Owning up to all my mistakes and decisions in this book, I know that other people are going to read that, and hopefully it's going to be motivation and a story of redemption for them.
Then, last year, Bristol got the chance to be a contestant on Dancing with the Stars. Many, including her dad, were against the idea.
None of my family really wanted me to do it just because they know I'm not that outgoing and I don't dance or anything like that. So they were like, Bristol, are you sure you want to do this?
The night you debuted, I'll never forget it. You come out in that gray suit, very conservative, but you showed the world that you can shimmy.
Well, thank you.
What did that experience do for your confidence?
I feel like people tried to break me down during that experience, but that just gave me that fire in my gut to do better.
You mean people that were actually there competing, your competitors, were not friendly to you?
Well, I think at first they saw me as like, oh, here's Bristol Palin, you know, she's not really that well known and she's not in this whole Hollywood scene. And so they didn't see me as competition, but the more we progressed and the further along we got, I think they kind of got a little bit upset.
Michelle Obama just came out the other day and thanked the media for being so kind to her children and for treating them with kid gloves. How can you explain the viciousness of the liberal media against you and your family?
I really don't think I can pinpoint or explain it, but it's definitely biased, and you know, there's some rude people out there, but we have tough skin and we know it's right.
You said God has ways of surprising you and pushing you further than you think you can go. Is that what happened to you?
Yeah, absolutely. With so many different examples between football and having Trip and Dancing with the Stars, and God has given me the guidance and the strength to push through it.
Wendy Griffith, CBN News, New York.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was gonna be cared for. I met with a doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were gonna die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they saved my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Well, just when you thought you couldn't get any more connected than through Facebook, think again. The social media giant has just friended another major communication tool. Facebook will soon offer the video chat feature Skype. The joint venture could triple or even quadruple Skype's video traffic, something both companies are excited about.
The best technology that's out there for doing video chat with the best social infrastructure that's out there in order to create some really cool new scenarios.
Should be exciting. That's all for this edition of NewsWatch. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time, and have a great weekend.